Oh. Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Cloud Chasers. Yes, you're
number 11.
Your eyes are not deceiving you. We are, in fact, alive and well. we had, as usual, a string of technical difficulties. Harbaugh's memory on his laptop was failing, and that's one of the reasons we couldn't record for a while. Then also, Harbaugh was away for a grading session. I want to talk about that a bit.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so we being Jackson and Guanrong, the first and third from Worlds, got an arrangement with Beckett to have the championship Woofies graded and like exclusive label type of stuff. So here it is. Of course, I had to showcase it. Oh, it's not really getting caught. I'll just attach a photo, but it looks pretty sweet. It has our signature on the label, and yeah, I also graded some other stuff along the way because Beckett very rarely shows up in Europe, and this was in Amsterdam, so I just graded a bunch of my prize card stuff.
That, and mine as well. Thank you.
I was going to get graded, and it was quite a cool, and Christian's as well, of course. Everybody from local community who wants some stuff graded, like, you don't get many chances to do it in Europe. But yeah, I took the chance, and was quite happy with the results. Obviously, the experience was really nice, seeing the guys again as well. The three Luffy's reuniting also had some charm to it. But yeah, it was like, the for the most part, a very peaceful month that we were gone. Just a lot of testing. One event, like the online that we played. But yeah, mostly just my laptop kept like breaking and dying, and I couldn't figure out why it was until one day it just completely died, and I got like the little the LEDs with what's called diagnostics just beeping out the code, and then I was like, oh, looked it up, figured out what it was, fixed it, replaced the broken parts, and now it works, and now we'll be back to podcasts weekly,
we hope.
And how was your month?
Yeah, this has been...
Yeah, we hope. How was your month in
a personal record
exam
for us. How long it took. Okay, well, for today, we have an abridged version of OPSM review because we missed so many slots that we really want to push the whole review. So we'll be just... we'll skip through all the chaff and we'll talk only about the notable cards. And with that, Hrva, shall we start the marathon? The sprint, I would say.
Of course. Yeah. The first thing we've got is the dragon, the red dragon from OPS7. That's what we're reviewing. He's an 8 cost 9k, has rush, and on play gives 2 rested dons to leader or one of the characters. So in effect, it makes him 6 cost 9k rush, which is insanely above rate. But also has synergy, specifically the Dragon Leader, where he can reattach the Rested Dawn and, you know, get double use out of them. Sorry, not Rested Dawn, the Attached Dawn he can reattach. But it also, like, works in all the leaders that just want to be aggressive to get an extra big swing and potentially, like, turn on the Dawn Attach effect, such as the one that Zoro has, where everything gains 1k extra, or the one that the upcoming Marco is going to have, where he can draw, put back, and redo something. Overall, something not that typical of red, it's top end. And aggressive top end as well. So this is a type that, unlike most high-costed units, it's not helping you win the game by prolonging, by giving you more resources. It just hopes to bring you to a close even faster. And for that, he's like a very efficient one-card package to do it, because he remains a big body that's going to keep attacking. And yeah, I have a few more things I want to add, but Christian, do you want to share your first impressions?
I usually want to always analyze a card, what it does on its own, right? You have an empty board, nothing, right? And so what does this card give you? So you are attacking for 9 and you're attacking for 7 with your leader, usually, right? Unless you're playing Vivi, but you would never play this card in Vivi. Now, how good is that? So, attaching to Dawn and swinging, usually, so requiring one additional card from your opponent, is most of the time stronger than drawing a card, right? So if this card was the same, so 8-9, draw a card, that's like comparable value, how good would it be? Well, pretty good, right?
I think I would like it if it drew a card rather than give to Bond.
The idea is that in red, aggression compounds, right? As in, the more 7k swings you can produce, the more awkward it is for your opponent, right? Basically, at a certain point, forcing them to counter a 7k to lead. We'll also discuss one other card a bit later that does something similar, and why the comparison is comparable. Anyways, 8-9 rush in and of itself, how good is that? Well, decent. Like, fine. You would not play that card. And that 2 Dawn is fine. Like, just fine. It's a card that exists. As in, it's, if you need top end, specifically on 8, it's a fine addition. But you will not be building your deck around Dragon, I think.
Yeah. So what I think is his main problem is, I often say this, but attackers, the best attackers are between 5 and 7,000 power, you know, basing their efficiency around that stat line. Because yeah, this 9k, it's always going to hit. And the only decks this is good against, like the 9k attacking stat line, is against decks that are happy to counter with multiple cards and just keep countering other attacks. Stuff like a blue, yellow queen or blue, purple Raiju, you know, the decks that don't like to give up life so easily. That's where like the big unit that just keeps swinging 9k, 9k, 9k over and over is good. But into other decks, for the most part of the game, you're swinging at their life for 5 to 7k, and you don't really need something this much over the top. You might need it to deal with board, but you know, as the game evolves, more and more of the board dealing effects are based around unit effects and not straight combat. So this becomes overkill against a lot of, you know, the typical decks that you want to be attacking. So yeah, he just turns out to be a big beater that, you know, it's not going to influence the board well enough. It almost is wasteful in how it dishes out damage. If he was 6-7 with this effect, then he would be really good. But 8-9 is a bit too expensive, a bit too late, and a bit too redundant with the 9k.
Okay, let's jump to Musk Deuce, who is a searcher. So he's an army searcher, basically one cost, 2 power, 2k power, a counter. He searches events and ace, if your leader is Porgus the Ace. And this kind of reminded me that maybe there is some play to Opio 3 Ace, red base, right? Because this is a nice consistency addition to that deck. You're basically running the package of small searchers. Izo, Dadan, Buggy, and now this Deuce, right? So we'll constantly have access to small efficient bodies, right? And red has a lot of good power reduction, so all those little bodies will be able to actually produce value at a certain point. All in all, cool card, support for an underground leader, but a leader which might see some cool resurgence, I think, because there's a couple of very good cards which are locked behind all those typings, right? 7 cost ace is a great card. Flame Emperor is
Flame Emperor also, is probably the biggest one. Good.
I'll definitely be spending at least some of the time for Ace. He's been in my heart for quite a while. Anything you want to add?
Well, yeah, I think he's basically a better buggy for Ace, just because having the flexibility of adding the best unit in the deck and one of the best units in the game alongside the option to add an event is very, very, very like relevant. Ace is not the type of deck that can always swing the small bodies, just because, especially in the turns where he's playing out multiple events, he doesn't really afford many Dawn to attach, so 2k versus 3k is not going to matter that often, and 2k is still enough to buff it with Machina and, have a threatening attacker. But yeah, just that added flexibility of what to search and having a counter on top is, you know, it makes him a really good searcher for specifically one deck. It's sort of a missed opportunity that the Ace leader in the starter is blue and yellow, because this is now effectively locked to one leader unless we get some, like, I hope red and blue Ace in the future, because there's a ton of blue Whitebeard support, and we already got the Marco, so why not give us another leader the same way that we got first Bella Betty and then the Sabo in the starter. So, yeah. All around, a pretty nice card.
Okay, you never complain about the Nami searchers, right? They are just direct upgrades in your deck, and whenever one of these appears, you're just like, let's spend some time, see what can be done. Okay, what about Uruj?
Yeah, let me just get to him. Uruj is a 4-cost 5k blocker with 1000 counter, and end of turn, set up to one Redon is active. This is the type of effect that we have seen previously, but it was on a much less efficiently statted unit. It was the 2k carrot in OPO 2, I think. Maybe OPO 3, where she was like 5-cost 5k, 2k.
3-4.
Oh, yeah, the blocker one, like the fat.
No. It's a 3-4. Has no other effect, just untaps your Dawn.
This is the one with like the horns? Yeah, okay, but Carrot was the first one. In any case, yeah, this is a Supernova, which is like the most relevant typing, and also Fallen Monk Pirates, which is completely irrelevant. Uruj finally gets like a proper playable card, because the one before, it was like semi-playable, the one that got plus 2k permanent if you had two more rested characters. I mean, 4-cost 5k blocker, not ideal. It's not, you don't usually want to block with those 5k blockers, which just means he's like a guy who's going to be attacking more than blocking. But his main purpose, specifically in Bonnie, is going to be to, you know, give you back that one Dawn end of turn, so he can play on curve but still get the leader ability. And that's that hyper specialized purpose that he currently has. Maybe some decks like Green, Purple, Doflamingo could also afford him if they ever choose to run some 3-cost events. But for now, yeah, he is a very special, like very niche purpose card, but he does it really well, and that's exactly what Bonnie wants, so I think he's a good card for what he's supposed to be.
Yeah, I mean, on the surface, the card is like mediocre. Like, you're paying 4 Dawn, you're getting 1 Dawn back, so kind of like, value-wise, he's a 3-5 blocker, which is fine. But yeah, the real value here is... and also, like, having a 5k blocker is... not really what you're looking for when you're building a deck, right? So what Uruj gives your deck is, hopefully, if he survives, Dawn up every turn for something. And that's something currently the strongest being Bonnie leader. So in a way, for Uruj, you basically want him to stick on the board and allow you to play on curve, which is good enough. I would never like cry home about and be like, oh no, I lost the game because I didn't have Uruj on curve. Like, it's just nice. There is one red card we skipped over. So let me get back to that. It's the new Ayn. Red Ayn, 7-cost 6k, which turns...
I need to find her. She's like...
Oh, there she is. She makes a character 0k. What makes that character interesting is that she allows efficient removal of very big bodies, right? And whenever you see reduction, currently at least in the meta, you are always considering red purple law, right? And in that deck, this card is most comparable to 7-cost Ace. Like the exact same slot in the deck. It's a 7-cost non-counter card. First thing, Ace has 1k more power, which is incredible, especially in this meta. 7k is not only the perfect setline for attacking, it's also way more harder to remove for law, right? So no longer one Gordon deals with the issue. Then they're serving two different purposes. With Ayn, you can like bottom deck, I don't know, 10-cost Dofi or 9-cost Zora or 10-cost Ace, like those big bodies, right? Well, Ace is more suited for, let's say, black or most notably probably RP mirrors, right? Where you can always deal with two bodies, bottom decking one and attacking into the other one. For example, currently the card finds slot as a tech option for law versus big bodies. In general, the card, like tool wise as it stands, it basically what casts a round table almost on a card. So if it's a 7-6, which on play casts a 4-cost event, that's decent. That's pretty good, actually, right? So all in all, a fine card. Definitely context dependent, right? Both on meta being centered around big bodies, which I would say it currently somewhat is. And on basically disrespecting RP law mirrors. The other synergies is, I guess, in Ace, where you can, I don't know, Seaquake something big, which is fine-ish. Also, you maybe have some KO when attacking effects. So in general, yeah, it's an answer for big bodies in red. Do you want to add something else, or shall we move on?
Well, let me just start from that last bit. You have Ace in Ace, and that's where he has Rush. I don't think this ever comes into consideration. But yeah, I think in the current meta where Red Purple Law is popular, just her stat line alone makes her not as desirable, but also her effect. Like, the meta needs to be really, really focused on these big bodies, but the problem is, if a meta is focused on big bodies, then Red Purple Law by default should like be doing like fairly well for himself, because he's a deck that really excels at punishing those decks that rely on, you know, climbing up the curve and dropping bigger and bigger bodies, because he just goes wide, and then that's how he obliterates those decks before they have a chance to stick all these big units. And yeah, Ayn or Ayn can immediately answer one of those, but like they probably already got their on-play value, because the only bosses you play are the ones with like significant on-play effects. And how much do you care about their swing? Well, you only care about their swing if they're going to kill you. Because the board, you can always rebuild, you can always fight for resources. So yeah, she just ends up in this weird spot where the what she's answering, she answers really well, but it's not what the deck itself wants to be answering. Whereas Ace, if you choose to run him, the 7-cost 7, he lets you like catch up from some scenarios where you perhaps fall behind on board, but now this one card lets you answer two bodies, one with the bottom deck, one with the swing, and that like turns the tables in your favor so much more, because now you get to establish your wider board, remove your opponent's wider board, and then even if they have like some big bodies, well, you still have like a semi-big body in Ace and all the other stuff you established. And it just works so much better to let you win. Like the only thing that's good about this card, like currently, is that it has infinitely better art than the Ayn from starter deck. Like, I'm so annoyed that the screenshots.
Those screenshots are definitely, I would say, the sole reason that people say that One Piece cards look bad.
I just don't think Ayn has like any real purpose nowadays. Because yeah, round table is a 4-cost event, but it's not. it's overkill for Ghost Event. Like, I think if you want maximum power reduction, it probably peaks around 6k. Like, anything more than that is more than you would want anyways. And even that might be overkill in most scenarios.
Let's go quickly to Otama then. She's an AMI searcher, but being a 0k power, she sports a 2k counter, which is pretty great. There's one concept here I want to touch on, and that is a concept I discussed in my Moria builds. The concept being of effective 2Ks in your deck. I see a lot of green players which are playing the Vana package. They play like, I don't know, 8, 10, whatever, 12 2Ks. But four of them are Otamas. And it doesn't really matter if you're playing a 2K in Otama, if you're playing her out, right? Then it doesn't really matter what the counter power is. So, yeah, you can pat yourself on the back that you have, I don't know, 12 2Ks in your deck, but if the four Otamas, you're always playing them when you see them, you're not having 12 2Ks, my brother. Why I'm talking about that? Because that was very relevant in, for example, in Gekko deck building, because both Sindri and Perona were very playable 2Ks. Tsuru often got played as well. So you needed to buff those numbers up a bit to still have the adequate amount of 2Ks. So Otama, great card. We already discussed Searchers. You know them, you love them. Great synergy with You Can Be My Samurai. Just keep in mind,
and just Wano has two searchers now. 2K, that's good.
But you're not off the hook for 2Ks if...
Because Momo,
you're not off the hook with 2Ks if...
Christian? I think we lost Christian. We'll see if he comes back or not.
We're back.
Yeah, you disconnected for a while. Okay, you can go on.
Yeah, I don't know where you lost me, but essentially, you're not off the hook by playing very playable 2Ks if you're most of the time just playing them out, right? That's what all I wanted to say.
Yeah, I mean, if you play Perona, you're probably between 14 and 15 2Ks because the Otamas are going to get played so often. But the nice thing is, Wano has two searchers now. Like, the engine is much more consistent. And, it allows for some deck building creativity. Overall, pretty nice inclusion in the set by Bandai. I'm sure it will be relevant in, a near enough meta as the archetype gets more and more support.
What about Bonnie Carver?
Okay, so Bonnie is 5+ 6k, 1000 counter, on play, up to one of your opponent's characters, or Dawn, which are rested, will not restand at the start of turn. It's like a mini Doflamingo effect, right? It's a bit of an odd, but very flexible effect, in that you usually want these no restand effects later on in the game, when there's like big units which are worth to deny the restand, so that you get maximum value out of the effect. But you can also do the cute thing with her where you just rest one of their Dawn, or like lock it, and they don't get to play their most powerful play on curve. For example, against Black Yellow Luffy, when they're about to go to 10 Dawn, you rest one Dawn, and suddenly Black Moria plus leader is not a play anymore, and they have to play way less efficiently, and you can apply this to pretty much any deck in the meta currently, except for maybe Red Purple Law. Like, he's the one that can get away with a Dawn list much easier than the rest. But yeah, she's a great piece of denying aggression. Very flexible, searchable, of course. I think she will never be like the meta defining card, but she will see some play as usually a 2-off, 3-off card. I would never look at this card as something you want to see every game in every situation. It's just like a situational defensive piece which has some flexibility to proactively disrupt your opponent.
Between two of us, I've been more focused on Bonnie theory and deck building, and the card's just fine. Sure, if it's a Magellan for a turn, it can be relevant, especially versus deck which have a more rigid game plan than aggro decks. Basically, aggro decks usually with the lower curve, they will just use additional Dawn either to drop an additional body or to swing higher. So therefore, you're not really disrupting them. But if a deck goes progressively through Dawn time slots, then you can completely turn them off. For example, I don't know, freezing one of the Dawns for black players when they're going to 8 Dawn can be very disruptive. Black Hail Luffy on 10, those little things are noticeable, right? Then freezing a big body later in the game, well, it doesn't really solve the issue, like that big body will still pressure you. So you have to really use something during that time, usually either clearing the rest of the board or applying pressure so you end the game before the unit once again becomes relevant. Fine card.
Yeah. Usually the aggressive purpose where you're just, you know, buying yourself time to kill them before they kill you.
Okay, now on to Hawkins, which is a card which single-handedly keeps green in contention versus black decks. He's a 6-cost 7k. He has blocker if your opponent, if your leader is a supernova. And then he has one of the weirder effects maybe ever printed in One Piece. So if he would leave the field by any effect, so bottom decking, bouncing, thrashing, KOing, anything, you can instead, once per turn, arrest one opponent character. What does this amount to? Well, basically, you have to have your whole board rested, then the effects can somehow remove him. And those effects, of course, cannot be on-play effects of characters, because then they came, then they come in to the field active, and Hawkins can rest them. So yeah, Hawkins is like the sole thing which enables you to play versus black. Sorry, games where you see two Hawkinses and just keep them on the board, keep pressuring, are usually the way you beat black. Incredible card. Black player's worst nightmare. There are plays around it, but they're very few and far between. Currently in black, we only have the event and the 3-cost Spruik. In general, the card is... So if the KO immunity is not relevant, then you just have a 6-cost 7k blocker, which is fine-ish. Like, fine-ish. The 7k blockers are pretty relevant, as you all are probably familiar mostly with, whatchamacallit, 7-cost blue key.
Kid.
Yeah. For all the old timers, yeah, the 7-cost kid. Those are pretty relevant, yeah. Usually you will get a card worth of value immediately after you play them, right? They'll usually absorb one of the hits. So it's almost like drawing a card, or maybe equivalent to them having a rush, right? Not really. It's definitely weaker than having rush, but like... You almost consider those bigger blockers as having an on-play of quote-unquote drawing a card, right? So yeah, Hawkins, pretty great. But do bear in mind, there are some matchups where he's just a 6k, 7k, 6-cost 7k blocker, and that is just fine. Do you want to add anything else?
Yeah, I think just, first of all, the way his effect works is kind of a new concept, like, and a broken concept in One Piece, where you get to... First of all, it's very lore appropriate, right? That he affects the opponent's units, but it's kind of broken. Like, you are defending your unit by reducing the efficiency of your opponent's board. And what this means is that even though he's a blocker, he's actually more efficient as an attacking unit. And to be fair, he does not have protection from dying by combat. But still, he's a 7k unit, so he either needs to have his power reduced or there needs to be some really big swing going into his face to KO him. But yeah, otherwise he's just a very resilient attacker that can turn to a 7k blocker at the snap of a finger. It's the same as all those other 7k blockers from the past. Like, you play that Luffy and he just kept attacking. Then maybe you would restand him with like the small Uta or something. And it's the same thing here. You attack with this guy and then maybe you just leave him active when you are unsafe and not sure if your opponent can finish you off. So yeah, very well designed card thematically. Very strong card. It definitely demands some respect from other decks in the meta. Like, if you're playing against Bonnie, you need to keep this card in mind. Because he could just blow you out entirely.
Yeah, as I said, I dislike the design complexity-wise. I think a lot of players struggle with how the card works.
Yeah, we already know, like, I think it's also bugged on the sim. If you, like, try to shambles, if you reduce him to 3,000 power, all your characters are rested, and you try to shambles him, the sim will make you play the character first, and then Hawkins can rest it. But that's not how it works. First, the law leader bottoms him and then summons the unit, so Hawkins can never protect himself from shambles if all the
but he units has on the board are rested. 7K, so he's harder to remove, right? You will need two reductions or Fire Fist. Anyways, good card. Do you want to share your thoughts about Papag?
Yeah, Papag is a very, very cute card. If you have a Kami character, he gains blocker. And he's 2 cost 2k, and the only subtyping is Animal, which is unfortunate because he's not searchable by the Kami character. But yeah, 2k blocker, that's a pretty, pretty nice place to be at 2 cost. The fact that he's conditional means that the Kami, if the Kami is removed, then he loses his blocking ability, and then he's just, sitting dead on the board, you wasted the card. But there's some potential there in the future, especially if we ever get the bigger Kami card that's like 5 plus 6 cost with some beneficial effect, maybe even protection. And this becomes a cheap blocker to have alongside her. Of course, the downside is you just compare this to like a Black Bartolomeo, and they're like, wait a minute. That guy's 3 cost 3k and a 2k blocker, and then this guy's just 2 cost 0. But yeah, he's a 2k, so just having that upside that he can potentially be a blocker is already above average.
Just an above average 2k, we definitely wanted to mention him. Now let's get to another card which is surprisingly on almost like a sleeper hit. Like, if this was somewhere in the previous set, this would definitely be a diamond in the rough. The card is called Fisher Tiger. He's a 5 cost 6k with a counter. Has an ability that this character can attack characters on a turn in which it is played. So he has a soft rush. Like, he has rush, but he can only attack characters. And then on play, if your leader is either a fishman or a merfolk, you can rest a 6 cost. I don't know about you, but I think this card is kind of pog. 5 cost 6k, we already have 5 cost 6k rusher, and it's gaining a lot of play. It's the Luffy, right? That card doesn't have a counter, and it has a pretty relevant ability. But this card has a counter, and if we ever get a good merfolk slash fishman leader, resting a 6 cost is... not a bad deal.
Yeah, that's punching way above its
You're essentially grade. Getting a small version of Hawkins, right? Hawkins. Hody Jones. Where you're only resting one thing, and he's only 6k. But has a counter, you're not losing life, and so on and so forth.
Yeah, I mean, just look back, way, way back to... OPO2 with Yamato, where she was 4 cost 6k, no counter, on play rest of 6k, and then increase the cost by 1 and add rush. Would you pay the extra 1 don for a counter and rush on a card?
I think you would always do that,
It's just a matter of currently being leader of two quite useless leaders. And we know at least in OPO 9, there's still no good merfolk slash fishmen
on the horizon. Yeah,
on site. Yeah, one thing that I do mind about this card is that it forces you to play your turn in what is generally the worst way to sequence things. You always want to you always want to first attack, hide your intentions, then play a card. But this, you immediately play a card, commit most or all you're done, and then you're attacking, and that makes it easier for opponent to make these choices on how to defend. And
but that's very similar to
of course if you first attack, Jones,
right? And we still know that he is a menace when it comes to.
Yeah, but Hody Jones can attack a leader, so that changes all the things. This can only attack the character, so. Yeah, it's not perfect, but you know, for a random rare from the set, quite solid. Mm-hmm. There's potential
like,
there.
I think you're definitely playing this in a Fishman / Merfolk leader once it comes out. I think the card is definitely good enough. Okay, what do you think about the new Luffy?
So the new Luffy is, I mean, it feels like a piece designed specifically for red green law to face black decks. You know, if you have three or more characters, all your characters would cost three or less, cannot be KO'd by your opponent's effects, except for Monkey D. Luffy. And he's 5+6, 1000 counter. It's this very specific purpose. He doesn't protect himself, but he does protect all the other stuff on the board. And so he's not looking at base cost, like, for example, the Rosinante from 04. He's just looking at current cost, so even if something that's like 6 cost is reduced to 3 cost, Luffy is going to protect it, as long as its name is not also Monkey D. Luffy. And yeah, I mean, it's a, I would say, a band-aid against black for a very specific deck, and I wouldn't put, you know, any high hopes on it. But it exists. It's like a nice piece of support. I wouldn't rate it very highly myself.
What about you? I think you're missing the synergy with Rosinante. The fact that Rosinante can protect this Luffy from being KO'd, and this Luffy can protect Rosinante from being KO'd.
I did not think of that at all.
Which then, especially in Bonnie, can make basically un-KO'able boards. Sure, you have to play a certain way, but let's say you have a Hawkins, which they couldn't remove, then you do Resonante into this, and you just keep this active for the whole game, and yeah, your opponent essentially can never KO your stuff.
When you put it that way, it does sound a bit
nasty. Huh? Yeah, it's definitely a cool tech for Bonnie versus Black, and probably needed because the black matchup is just that bad, even with the addition of Hawkins. So yeah, a weird card. It's one of those cards where you see that they designed it specifically to be like a bandit. Like, here you go, here's some help if you need help versus black, right? But an interesting card nevertheless. Okay, let's now move on to blue, and let's talk about Crocodile 2K. I keep telling you, I really believe that, sure, black got some really strong 2Ks, but blue, for quite a long time, has been having banger 2Ks. And Crocodile is no exception. Like, he's a 4-cost 5K, we already like that, right? And for the cost of one Dawn on play, you get to bounce, what it is, a 1-cost? No, a 2-cost. Yeah. You can either bounce your opponent's blockers, or more probably you're bouncing your own searchers and therefore drawing a card or Piranhas. Also notable, he's a 4-cost 7 Warlords of the Sea. 7 Warlord, yeah. And Baroque Works, of course. Which is very relevant for both card coming up and the Dofi leader. A menace of a card, like, such a bump in power. Like, whenever you get these kinds of playable 2Ks with synergy points, with good typing, that's just a power increase for a deck. Not much more to say. You just jam this guy into your deck.
Well, I have a lot to say. First of all, when I look at Blue in this set, I just think of the world that never was. And that's a world where Sakazuki gets access to all the seven warlord support, because Sengoku Searcher can search Moria. And then, since you obviously need other targets, cards like this Crocodile naturally come up, where he would just be a 4-cost 5k that can bounce a 2-cost. But in Sakazuki, obviously, that extends to pretty much any cost. And then you have a 2k that's efficient removal and searchable. So it's kind of like Virgo, but in the other direction, and letting you play Sengoku for the searchable Moria. I think that synergy could come up easily in the future if we get another black and blue leader that's like solid. So it's always something to keep in mind. Obviously, there's the synergy with Doflamingo and I guess the Boa as well, because you return your Sengoku draw card. So yeah, just all around a really good 2k, like 4-cost 5k. I think we've talked endlessly about how good of a stat line that is for 2ks. It's like pretty much the best you can have, the best in the business. And yeah, just really good stuff.
What about Maria, by the way?
The 5-cost 6k, no counter. Once per turn, if your leader has 7 Warlords of the Sea, and this character would be removed, you may place one of your characters other than Gecko Moria at the bottom of the owner's deck instead. Honestly, I don't like this card. Like, I'm sure we're including it because you like it, but I really don't like these types of cards that use your own cards to protect themselves, and they have no other benefit. Like, if he sticks on the board, he's just a overpriced vanilla. He has no counters, so you have to play him out. And yeah, you're still not keeping him for free. You're paying the price by bottom decking one of your other things or removing. So yeah, you need to play a searcher before this, then you need to play this, and all of that for a 6k attacker just does not sound very appealing to me.
I don't like the card either. It's just been propping up in a lot of lists, so I thought it was
I see.
To discuss it. So basically, it's a way for Blue to.
We're just shitting on cards.
Well.
And I know we have another example of this coming up, so I approve. That's how we do things.
So it's a way to tech for black. Okay. You have to have a searcher or something that you laid out, got the value, it was low costed, and then this can remain. The stat line is not that good, doesn't have a counter. Once again, he's not immune to being run over. There's just too many things going against this card, in my opinion. Sure, it does give you some percentage versus black, but this card sucks into almost any other matchup. And please, don't run Moria. Just a subpar card. Jinbe, on the other hand.
Yeah.
Is in contention for being the best blue card, maybe ever.
A proper bastard, I would say.
Jinbe is a 4-cost 5k. 7 Warlords of the Sea, once again, very important. And he has an on play effect of. Did I say he has a counter? He has a counter. On play, play up to 1 7 Warlords of the Sea with a type of 4 less other than Jinbe from your hand. Notable 4 costs are Gecko Moria and Weevil, which all draw you a card. And the other being the 2Ks. You can play a vanilla, but Weevil and Moria are the Saturn Moria, right? Are probably the most notable ones. The other notable thing is you can play him from the top with the Flamingo. And the dreaded go first, drop this into Weevil. So for 3 Dawn, you swing 7, you get 2 bodies without spending a single card from your hand. That is definitely the most broken 3 Dawn turn you can ever have. I guess Porsche into Ichiji is somewhat better, but like you're losing
I mean, it's definitely better.
You're losing 2 downs.
In a deck that likes to lose down.
That early? I mean, sure, versus RP Law. Anyways, pretty strong. I think, I mean, even Boa will play this out simply because it's that efficient of a play, right? If you think about it...
Yeah, it's, sorry? It's bullshit is what I wanted to say.
If you think about it, we were even playing Ulti Page 1, I mean, almost quite recently, right? Because it was a very strong Swarm the Board play. Sure, Ulti is a 2k, but she also minuses your Dawn. You have to play a Vanilla, which is not something you generally want to do. And it also has to combine those two cards, right? Jinbe can combine with almost 20 cards in your deck. So, yeah, most of the time when you have Jinbe in your hand, you can play him out and cheat out another 4-cost. The card is just insane, yo. Wanna add something else?
Nah, card's broken. Like, thanks Bande, I guess.
Thanks Bande. What about Boa?
Let me just scroll. Where is she? Okay. So she's 6-cost 8, no counter on play. Choose a character other than Monkey D. Luffy. He cannot attack until opponent's next turn, and place one character with cost 1 or less to the bottom of the owner's deck. First of all, that vanilla stat line, that's what we love to see. 6-8 is maybe a bit overkill, but, you know, given the... Like, 6 is still low enough of a cost to make it work, and 8 is, like, a terrifying stat line, especially when looking from perspective of somebody who plays Red Purple Wall. Like, when this thing comes down, you're not outing it. Once again, there's this world that never was where you could also run this in Sakazuki for the freeze and the removal of one cost, which in Sakazuki would be any pretty much any cost. But yeah, it's a very strong effect on a very strong body. And obviously in the ball leader, you can abuse it extra by bottoming your own Sengoku and drawing a card. A great stall tool, a very strong attacker once on board. It has a lore aspect where she does not affect Luffy, similar to how Enel didn't. But yeah, overall a very strong card, searchable, in both archetypes that can play her, so yeah, really not much to complain about.
Yeah, just yeah. A good card. For example, unlike Dragon, this card is just good. Whenever you play, right? You just pop it down. They probably have a thing on board, so you're saving yourself one attack. It's a vanilla stat line, relatively hard to remove, both power-wise and cost-wise. Bottom decking one cost aggressively is not irrelevant. Additional synergy with the ball leader, you covered it all. I just want to emphasize how the floor of this card is so high that you might even consider this a blue staple. Okay, let's talk about... we glanced over Sengoku Searcher. You know our stance on Nami Searchers. Like, those will always be like 5 out of 5. Cards, those are just great. So not much else to discuss there. Law 2K is an interesting card. He's a 4-cost 4K, 7 Rollers of the Sea, very notable once again. 2K counter, and you may return it to your hand, and then if your opponent has 6 or more cards, they take one card from hand and bottom deck it. So they don't trash it, they bottom deck it. Which is good versus Nami. It's good versus black decks because they don't have access to the card. They bottom deck it, right? And it also has an added synergy with Boa. We might even want to discuss Boa as a leader, I think, because there are some things to mention. Anyway, Would you play for pay for Dawn for your opponent to discard a card? I don't think you would, ever. Like maybe when you if you're playing versus the stall decks like NLs and Lucky Luffy's, right? But in general, spending for Dawn just to force your opponent to discard a card is not where you want to be.
Yeah, in a vacuum, this card isn't, you know, that potent. It obviously, the thing it aims for is what to specifically support the Boa leader, because she has a few of those effects where she, you know, plants a 2k on the board and then returns it to the hand later. There's the, I think, Pudding is the other one that does it. And, you know, because you want to reduce your hand size, you can get the leader ability and then you get the extra benefit here because you can attach it on, swing 5, then use this and, you know, take 2 cards out of your opponent's hand and in one swoop and, you know, get the 2k back to your hand, effectively drawing it. It's very niche for one leader, amazing art, thematically once again, a wall for some reason, besides the shambles also just strips opponent's hand in one piece. This is the third card that wall has that affects hand size. But yeah, overall, just a very niche type of support.
I wouldn't
that...
say it's niche, because there's quite a lot of additional synergy points. For example, if you flip it off the top from Doflamingo, you just draw a 2k and they discard a card. Not as good as getting like a...
Oh, okay, yeah.
Not as good as getting a, I don't know, a 6k and drawing a card, but better than a miss, right? It's like your low roll with Jinbe, basically making Jinbe a Perona almost. Enough synergy pieces to make the card decent, I think. And just playing it out for 4 Dawn is almost fine. It's definitely fine versus deck which are trying to starve you and... run you out of resources, like NL Blocky Luffy. But in Bo, would you play this to make your opponent discard a card and you draw a card? You
probably
can consider that, yes. Especially if there's...
Yeah, I mean, ideally always play Pudding in that situation. And we know that Pudding, as bullshit as she can be, she's not... always the best play just because you're not fielding anything of value. She's just a 4 plus 4k. This law doesn't field anything because he returns himself to hand, so it's like a way, way worse Pudding. I do still think he's quite niche, but yeah, he's a searchable 2k. And
I think you also bring up a good point. Yeah, he doesn't really play well with Pudding because Blue already has access to dealing with decks which want to accumulate a big hand size, right? And if you're playing out laws, you're making your future Pudding threat less viable. Because if you're playing versus Blue and you have like 7 or 8 cards and they're swinging like 7, 8, 9 to your face, you are asking yourself, like, can I really take this and walk into Pudding? So yeah, a decent card for sure. And a pretty cool alt art. Hrubi, what do you think about the new blue Doflamingo?
So he's a 3 cost 4k, 7 worlds of the sea / Don Quixote Pirates, activate main, once per turn, rest 2 Dawn, reveal 1 card from the top of your deck. If it's 7 warlords, cost 4 or less, you may play it rested and place rest on the bottom. I mean, if it's not you, just place it on the bottom. So he is a Doffy leader ability on the character, but on a character with no counter, and it's only 3 cost, meaning it's easily removable. I quite like it in terms of how the card is designed, just because it reminds me of Sentomaru, except, you know, it's not guaranteed. This one needs some setup to bring out the unit, but also ends up being cheaper. But I like those types of cards where they're like an engine you set up on the board, and it just stands there and generates value if it works, you know. There's no guarantee it will work, but it is a very, you know, appealing prospect. Would you want to run this specifically in the Doflamingo leader? Probably not, because your leader already has this effect. But in some other blue leader, possibly, I guess Boa is the main candidate. And this does open up some lines of play that allow for like a more swarm heavier play style, like playing this in 3 and then on 5 playing the Doflamingo blocker, checking top 5, using the ability, getting something out. That's a good way to generate value. Is it necessary in this meta? Probably not, especially in a non-counter card, because preferably just play down Jinbei and get that value immediately. But this is a card that, you know, with some proper, with some setup, it can lead to like proper good results and strong boards. I would not advocate it for in the current.
Let's say play Perona and you see like 2 or 3 seven forwards, you can just stagger them out and you play multiples of them, right? So being in a position where you can both use this and your ability is very, very niche. So I also agree. I think it's a way to add Dofi leader ability to other blue decks, which want to run the seven walls of the C package. He does have his weaknesses, yeah, being an uncounter card, needing setup, but we have way more than enough of strong seven warlord package that he might be a consideration always down the line, right? Currently, so the removal is just too easily achievable, but a card to keep in mind for sure. Okay, Hiroe, what about Ace?
Well, let me just find him. Oh, there he is. So he's a 5+6k blocker, 1000 counter, YB Pirates type. And on play, draw 2 and place 2 from hand on top or bottom of the deck in any order. I mean, that's just a solid effect. Like, we like the filtering effects. Obviously, something like Sabo, which tosses the cards away, is better. But we know why this Ace is designed this way. It's for the synergy with Marco that's coming up in OPO8, who also applies his effect in the same way, where you're kind of like fixing the top or bottom of your deck for Whitebeard Pirate Swarm effects, because there's going to be that new... Is it also Ace, the one that summons from top?
Yes.
Yeah, so you're just setting up pieces for swarming the board with Whitebeard Pirate types cards. I mean, 5+6k is like the ideal blocker stat line. Preferably, you would want it to bring you card positive, such as, for example, Queen does, or the green law has the potential to. But to be fair, this one does have a counter, so he's paying some of the power budget to have the counter rather than give you the extra card. But yeah, overall, like, a solid card. Nothing to write home about.
What we have to discuss are all the synergy points. One of them is, of course, being played in Ace Leader. Like, this card single-handedly made me build a deck, because it brings a lot of safety to that build. You're adding one more 5-cost Big Brother, which is very important in that deck, because you really want to hit those. That's one thing. The other thing is... you can also set up future hits with the leader, right? If you play him out, you have a 5-cost in hand. Just put him second from the top. And on your next turn, you can reveal that dude as well. Also, currently, Sanji is still a card. If you, I don't know, have a Mihawk in hand, play this, put Mihawk second from the top, and then next turn play Sanji. It doesn't line up because... you would have to play this on 7 Dawn, but still. And now we have Sanji and Mihawk for 9 Dawn, which is pretty insane. So yeah, pretty decent card. As I always talk about Sabo, I generally dislike the 5-cost 6k blockers, because I feel like it's... 5 Dawn is moving into most of your turn territory, Dawn-wise, and just getting a decent blocker is... like, it's just passable. Like, I really dislike playing Sabo in black, and it oftentimes feels like just spinning the wheel, setting up, but not doing anything impactful. And this kind of reminds me of that. So the payoff needs to be big. Saba is overall a better card. He has a good effect, and this card is pretty strong in black. So you really need to get a lot of mileage out of top decking a cool card.
Like he has a whole another effect slap on top of
Saba does, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
And even then, I'm still kind of low on Saba, especially compared to the rest of the populace. Okay, Margarita or whatever. She's
Marge.
Oh yeah. Do you want to quickly do Ball Leader?
I mean, we can, but this is gonna take ages.
Just trust and believe. Let yourself embrace the set review.
People know what Boa Leader does, I think.
Then I'll just quickly say about Boa that it's a leader which really wants to counter. The whole idea for the leader is almost like you're playing it almost like you would Imankov. Basically, countering really aggressively and then getting value out of your leader ability, right?
I think you would compare. I thought you would compare it to Rebecca because that's Rebecca the one that she actually plays like a lot.
Probably not. Probably Rebecca is definitely the better comparison. But yeah, so just be mindful counter very often. Okay, Margaret. She's a 3 cost 2k blocker without a counter, and she draws a card on play. So we already saw. A lot of people are running the new Kaija? Amazon Lily? Kuja?
I think it's Kuja.
Kuja Pirates.
I hope it's not Kuya because then it's just it's dirty in creation. I think it's Kuja Pirates.
In Nami, right? Because this card is card neutral. Digs you through the deck. Like, we joked in locals that every time there's a blue card which says draw a card, all the Nami players perk up from their caves and see what's going on. In general, this card also has some synergy with being bounced because it's a relatively low-costed draw card. I'll mention her when we discuss the other events, which basically bounce cards to hand. A very inconspicuous card, but resource-wise, it's decent. Like, it's almost like a bailiff, right? So you're drawing a card, and you have a blocker on board, which they have to remove, or you get to block. And also, you get some synergy with them being able to, I don't know, bounce or things like that. Problem is less than 3k, so law freely bottom decks her, which is horrible, especially for Nami. Any conspicuous card, not something to write home about, but is relevant. Like, and if some point down the line we get a really strong control package for blue, and blue can just use these like efficient stalling tools, for example, the Raging Tiger, the new 7 cost event, not new from the previous set, which can bottom deck 2/6 cost, is a great way to move the color in that direction. Like, that's a excellent control tool, and this card also like adds to that package of playing efficiently and slower. And do you want to add anything else?
I just think it's like, yeah, it says draw one card on a body that's also a blocker. It's default inclusion in Nami and probably not anything else for the time being. But yeah, just a solid card. One thing that does annoy me about the card, though, when you look at the art, she's notching an arrow, but there's no string to the bow, so like...
She just pushes the arrow.
I haven't... There's no way she's just pushing the arrow. I mean, I don't remember the Boa Island lore, but what the hell? What kind of magic bow is that? That's all I got on the card.
Now let's talk about the two events. We'll mention them together. So the first one is Snake Dance, which gives you... So it's a two-cost counter effect, which gives you 4k, and then you can return one of your characters. The trigger is return one of your own, and then you can return one of your opponent's. And Slave Arrow is one cost. It has a cost of you having to return a 2-cost or more character, and then you get a 4k. And the trigger is draw 2, and not discard 2, but put them back on the bottom. This is the moment that we're like, oh, Nami exists, and let's be careful with that. So both of these events are essentially being... they all hinge on you being able to bounce something and getting value out of that, right? Yeah. And in general, that's pretty good. Like, you can bounce Margaret. The thing is, for example, what not a lot of people do, and it was one of the stronger plays in the pre-release, is you can block with Margaret, the three-cost blocker, right? And then bounce her with the event. So you completely nullify an attack, and you have Margaret still in your hands to play next turn.
Yeah, some people didn't do it because they weren't lucky enough to pull Margaret, just saying.
You just have to pull Margaret and the event. I don't know. You've got six packs, dude.
Yeah.
Six
packs. And the 8-cost Mihawk. And the 8-cost Mihawk, and yeah.
Build different, very what cool. Can I say? Anyways, once again, most notable in Nami, value engine, right? You're countering and not losing a card.
Specifically Snake Dance, not the Slave Arrow.
Only has a target of Margaret, and you cannot guarantee that you're gonna hit Margaret. But Snake Dance can bounce Kaya's, the Searchers, and so on. Of course, we didn't mention it, but once again, they also got the Searcher, Queer Pirates, and Amazon Lily. Cool card. Okay. Parfum Femur is another addition to the whole blue arsenal. It's a 2-cost, essentially a Diablo Jumbo, but an even better one. For one additional cost, you're getting 2k power. Ooh. So with Diablo Jumbo, you were losing power. With this, you're not losing any power, right? You're paying to done and you're getting done. These kind of effects are always relevant. Like, I think whenever you're playing versus blue, at least I am. I'm always considering this card if I'm going down to zero. Like, ooh, I'm dead to Femur. Very similar to how you approach Diablo Jumbo in red matchups. But this card is overall better. I would say it has a stronger trigger. The card is even getting played in Nami for the trigger and the typing, right? And it's an overall stronger card. So, yeah, a great addition to blue. And something to always keep in mind, I think. Would you add anything?
Yeah, it's just better Dimble Jimbles. Honestly, not a fan of this design in general in card games. But yeah, it does force you to not go down to zero life. Which, to be fair, blue forces you to not go down to... to not go down to zero life easily from the beginning, because there's big bodies, there's pudding, there's so many ways to punish you for unnecessarily taking your life. This is just like a bit of extra of that on top, because obviously it's not just for the leader. You can play this on Boa and swing 18k to face, and you're probably not countering off of this. It's like the main card that main card that blue has against Black Yellow Wolf is pudding, but this will be the second most important one, because if they're not careful, if they're just trying to go to 9k and they're not trying to set up 9k with one life instead, then you just can completely blow them out with this one. But yeah, that's pretty much all I gotta say on the card. Nami just plays it for the trigger and to discard flutter it, so it's like alright design. But I'm not a fan of that type of cards in the card games.
Let's move on to Foxy as a leader. He has a very strong, very weird effect. So he's a 5 life, 5k purple leader. When attacking, dawn minus 3. And now here comes the really bad part. If you have 3 or more Foxy Pirate type characters, oof, that's quite a lot. Select your opponent rested leader and up to one of your character card. Up to one of their character cards, I mean. And then selected cards will not become active in the next refresh phase. Basically being Dofi, Tenko's Dofi, right? But without paying 10 done. The requirement is just very, very steep. 3 Foxy... not only do you have to have 3 characters in play, they have to be Foxy, which really, really silos you deck building wise. But the effect is very strong. Value wise, it's at least 2 cards, probably more. It's essentially because Dofi most of the time will freeze 2 characters and a leader, but a lot of the times Dofi will just freeze 1 character and a leader, and this basically does that. Incredibly potent ability. Just unlocking it is the question. Hrve, anything to add?
I think he's just... just too demanding. Like, 3 characters is... If you can fulfill that condition, well, you're probably doing well enough on the board anyways to not specifically care about whether you're locking your opponent's characters or not. The counter argument to this would be, well, you just play out 3 cheap characters and enable the effect on the same turn, because as we know, Foxy has a lot of cards that ramp him, so you could technically make up the Dawn immediately, but the issue is then you're just throwing away your hand size to facilitate the effect in hopes of, that same hand being like fake counters because the leader and the character are not attacking. But then there's also downside of opponent's leader and opponent's character already have to have attacked, and you might not be in the best spot if that already happened, and you cannot walk away the stuff that's just now coming into play. It feels like there's a lot of hoops to jump through, but maybe there's something there in the future with more support, but it's not the first leader I would look towards if I was excited about Purple's prospects as a solo caller in the meta.
Good, fair. What about Sanji 2k blocker?
No, I'm just fine. Oh, there he is. So, I mean, busted. Giga busted. So he's a 6 cost, 6,000, 2,000 counter that has a blocker. And if that was all of it, this card would already be, one of the better 2Ks out there, because it's like a, what's the word for it? Thought experiment we already had. Like, what if there was like a 7 cost, 7K, 2K? Just that, right? It's just like this really big unit you can play for its cost, and then it does something. Or like it attacks. It's relevant on the board, mm-hmm. is what I'm trying to say. And then this guy, he's a 6K body, and then he's also a blocker. But that's not it. That's not it. If you have less done, 2 less done than your opponent, 2 or more less done, obviously, he becomes 3 cost. And then then you're just cheating the world. It's absurd.
Mm-hmm.
Like, blockers don't win you games, but highly efficient units do win you games, and Sanji easily becomes one in pretty much every purple deck that wants to run him. Like, and worst comes to worst, he's a 2K in your hand.
Yep.
Like, there's really no downside to this, and to top it all off, he's a Straw Hat Pirate card. So he's searchable by the most relevant typing in the game, because as we know, there's cards, there's no guarantee Foxy is going to get any future support
Straw
Hats, as a leader. But are Straw Hats going to get future support? Guarantee. Like, we already know there's the Zoro Searcher in the starter deck, like the 4-6 that searches purple Straw Hat cards. And there's going to be many more in the future. There's the event that searches like Straw Hat Kid or Heart Pirates cards. Bandai went out of their way to make a really busted 2K. Like, the only thing that's missing is a Germa tag so that at age you can also search him, but, you know, they had to stop somewhere.
We take what we can get. Chopper, on the other hand, is not as busted, but I would say still decently busted. So he's a 2-cost blocker with a counter. So, like, already we saw previously that that's what you get, right? You pay 2 to give your blocker also a counter in your hand, right? Sure, they would have 2k power, but that power would really matter. And for losing that measly 2k power, you're getting a pretty strong effect. The effect is, if the number of Dawn on your field is equal to or less than the number of Dawn on your opponent's field, basically all the requirements of Rangers, right?
Ranger birds?
Yeah. You add up to 1 Dawn card from your deck and rest it. So, in general, ramp effects are worth quite a lot. Like, historically, they're worth about 3 Dawn or an additional card, right? There's a lot of things that would discard a card to ramp or pay about 2 or 3 Dawn to ramp, right? So you're getting 2 or 3 Dawn slash 1 card worth of value on play. That's pod racing, as they say. Great card. To top it all off, a couple of synergy points, namely with Porsche.
We'll get to Porsche. So
yeah, plays great into with both Reiju and Law. Discard.
Yeah, like in the past, the only 2-cost unit that we had which ramped was the ulti from OPO1, and she's 2-cost 3k, no counter, and on play you had to pay 1 to ramp, so it was effectively 3 Dawn, 3k ramp. And then this, obviously had to deramp at some point first to be able to get this effect, or your opponent had to ramp ahead of you. But for just 2 Dawn, you just need to squeeze 2 Dawn extra in your turn, and you get a ramp, which lets you play catch up. And that's quite good. Now, obviously, we know there's some insane busted cards coming out in OPO 8 that make this look like child's play, like 1 Dawn. Oh, wow, you can just get 5. But he's a blocker. He's a searchable, which we'll get to in a bit. Like, well, around a solid card and counter, one that already sees
again,
play in...
The card you're mentioning is a 2k counter.
Yeah,
so, Chopper. Pretty good card. Now, what about the Super Foxy? Let me take this one, and then you'll take the Porsche, because I know you really like your Porsche. Okay, so Foxy is a 7-cost 7k without a counter. And then during your opponent's turn, if your leader has the Foxy Pirate type, you give all your opponent characters minus 1k power. And then, once per turn, you can add, you can ramp it on. So ramping and on every turn is pretty good, pretty strong. So basically you have Onigashima now, right? Pretty good. Then to top it all off, you also get minus 1k on everything on the board, which essentially turns you into Whitebeard, right? As long as this is on board.
Yeah.
The combination of those two things, basically de-accelerating your opponent trying to pressure you, and accelerating your Dawn. I mean, accelerating. Yeah, at that point you're on 8 Dawn, next turn you're on 10. Basically, this will just nullify one of the minus Dawn effects, right? For the next turn. But, definitely, on paper, the card is nice. You play it, it does things, no crazy like synergy pieces, it's just a strong card at what it does.
Yeah, I think it's unfortunate that he's leader locked, just because I think there would be some really neat potential and like contention for spots in purple decks in general if he was.
I think he was all in other leaders because
like, what card is he?
He's almost a better 7-cost kid, right?
Yeah, that's the card I wanted to compare him with. Like the difference is kid effectively imposes the 1k difference on the leader as well. And also, it stays after a kid is removed, but this ramps you. So, yeah, it would be the same slot they would be fighting over. And I assume Foxy would probably win just because stacking multiple Foxys would be, like, pretty insane. Like, getting 2 Dawn every turn instead of losing 2 Dawn every turn with 2 kids, it would be quite strong. But, yeah, as it is, he's like a solid boss for this mini archetype they cooked up. Which they do from time to time. Like, we keep getting, like, the random Merfolk, the Foxy Pirates, the... I don't know. I'm sure there's a bunch of other examples, but I'm blanking. Revolutionary Army, whatever. Yeah, he's a solid boss for specifically this... little deck.
What about Porsche?
Okay, yeah. Next up is possibly my favorite card from this set, and I think the one that has the most... or, like, the least amount of future-proofing... ingrained into the card. So Porsche is a 3-cost 5k. She has on play Dawn minus 1. Look at top 5 cards of your deck. Search a Foxy Pirates type card, which includes herself. Mm-hmm. She does not she cannot herself. And then play any purple 4k power or less character from your hand. Active, of course. And like, I cannot really, like, the effects which allow you to cheat out value are always good. And the potential that this has to cheat out value both now and in the future is, like, through the roof. First of all, playing her does not necessarily lose your card from hand if you just play her for the search effect. Because what's the worst that can happen? Like, you whiff and you play something. Or you don't have anything to play, but you find, like, a chopper and play chopper, and then you got a 3-cost vanilla... a blocker, and you didn't lose any Dawn for it, which is for just one card from hand, which is already a good trade. But then we look into synergies, and the first place you look is obviously Reiju. I think if there's any deck that profits from Porch in this meta, Reiju is the number one contender. Like, all the small rangers are targets, so you're allowed to do some really explosive stuff with Ichiji specifically. Just play Porch on 3. Like, just the fact you can play out small Ichiji for 3, and yeah, you will minus Dawn twice, once from Porche, once from Ichiji, so you'll be Dawn minusing a lot. But yeah, you get that 7k body for 3 cost, which is quite insane. Allows you to overpressure almost every deck in the game very consistently, provided you do see all the pieces in your hand. That's like the biggest drawback. But then there's just the potential to abuse this card in any purple deck in the future. Because already there's some solid targets out there with, like, Bonkle and the... I'm not sure if it's Heat or Wire, the one that gets plus 2k when the Dawn is minus from the start deck. Then there's the Zorajuro, the 2k Khalifa, the Chopper, obviously, from Foxy Pirates archetype. And as soon as there's some, like, Vivi type of card, you know, the 7-cost 4,000 power... Mm-hmm. In the future, then Porche Stongs just go through the roof, because now you have the ability to cheat out this high-cost unit very, very cheaply, and possibly, like, completely break the game off of it. And that's the type of potential I like to see in a card. You know, even if it's not present in any of the best decks right now, there's nothing saying that it won't be in the future, because ultimately, she's very comparable to Ulti plus Page 1 combo, except she doesn't have a 2k like Ulti does. But she pairs with, like, almost everything in the purple card pool. And, yeah, that's just the type of card I love to see. The proactive plays that can completely blow out the game.
Yep. Well said. And you even mentioned the way which I wanted to do. So, yeah. Let's talk about Slow Beam. The events, the counter events are really good. But Slow Beam Sword is an effect that we rarely see. So it's a 2-cost counter-event, Dawn minus 1. Up to one of your leader characters gains 2k, so it's a 2k in hand only, but then you can rest one of your opponent characters regardless of the cost. And it has the usual purple trigger of ramping you. So the fact that it only gives you 2k power is kind of weird, that they didn't give you at least 3. But being able to rest any character might throw some people off. Like, currently I don't think this is good, but at some point in the game, just being able to arrest any character might be very relevant. I also wanted to say about Porsche is that she kind of puts a somewhat premium on Foxy Pirate cards, as you probably want to run at least 12 of them to, like, from time to time get a free card, right? So currently that would be probably her, Chopper, and a 2k, Gina. But not maximize, but like to get to a very decent spot, you would probably want to run ideally around 16, 15 Foxy Pirates to like relatively consistently hit with Porsche. So all the other Foxy Pirate cards are getting, I would say, a decent bump, because like Porsche is that insane of a card, which, as I said, adds stocks to Soslo Beam Sword. But unusual effect in the game, and possibly relevant in the future.
Yeah, it would require very specific like attacking setups from the meta decks to make Soul Beam better than Judgment of Hell, I think. Just because, you know, spreading the minus, like being 2 cost minus 6k across two bodies, I think is generally more accessible because it counters directly the usual 7k swings. Whereas this, you know, completely turns off one swing, but it doesn't get you out of the most common 7k swing when somebody's pressuring, and that could be highly detrimental to, well, your hand economy. Like, just keeping cards in hand to play with.
Okay. Let's move on to black. The first thing up is Kaku.
Okay.
Go for it.
Okay, so Kaku is a 4-cost 5k unit with 2,000 counter. So, you know, the best stat line we love to see on the 2k units. And on play, you place two cards with CP in your trash to the bottom of the deck and give minus 3 cost to something during this turn. And overall, you know, it's solid, like 4-cost 5. He's like the, when you look at the premium black 2k, when you look at Perona, he only brings half of her effect. He has to pay for it by bottom decking two very specific cards from the trash. So it's like he's combining the worst aspects of Perona and like Absalom into one CP card. He has an alright stat line, but he's very much, you know, you're obviously going to run him because he's a searchable 2k, but he's very much a card that, you know, you'll play him. Yeah, you'll play him if you must, but ideally you don't want to play him. Like, specifically from my experience, I much rather find myself playing Khalifa, you know, to get the filter and apparently still the minus 2 cost, so that usually gets you the cost reduction you need anyways in the stages of the game where you want to play these cards in the first place. Obviously, Kaku can serve as a better attacker down the line, but he's much more costlier to your graveyard setup, which is something that the black as a color values very, very highly. So, you know, threat
especially
carefully.
Now with Lucci,
he's
who really needs inclusion. To find to put Lucci somehow in the trash, right? You have a non-cutter card,
yeah,
which
and
you
ten cards for
have to put into your trash, which is not the easiest thing to do. Yeah, but once again, being a 4-5 2k is relevant. Like, dropping this on 4 instead of just passing a turn is something that I would do, right? So, yeah, Kaku. Cool addition.
He's going to do the next slam that giraffes do, like, and I just...
Now, we will talk about a card that we both really disliked. and we both might find ourselves eating our words. It's Tusi.
Oh, I spoiled what. It's fine.
Stussy is a 9-cost 9k with an on-play CPO. Pretty relevant, I think. So an on-play, you may trash one of your characters, KO up to one of your opponent characters, so anything. So, let's talk about why we dislike Stussy. So, first thing is the setup, right? You kind of dislike having to set up your cards, but currently, as it stands, with your residue Khalifas, Spandines, Spandams, that might not be the worst thing. And you can always, for Tendon, keep a Spandam in hand if you have to. Fine. Then, the fact that she KOs anything, more often than not, felt like an overkill. You're playing black, so you have access to some excellent reduction tools. Leader, Stage, Kuzan, Tempest, Kikisho. Just have a ton of reduction, right? So why put a card which has no synergy with that reduction, where you can put more efficient cards which synergize with the good thing you have in your deck, right? And then, after playing a lot, you find out that sometimes you just don't have the reduction. Sometimes your deck kind of bricky, and your opponent can get to late game and start dropping big bodies. And at that point, you'll probably have to lose too many resources to get rid of those bodies. And then, just playing one Stussy and taking back the tempo is nice. Well, it is very like anecdotal, but I lost a locals game where it was pretty fine. I did a lot of pressure.
Matchup?
They dropped Isha. I'm like, well, fine. I'm on point.
Which matchup?
Fine. I do some pressure. They play Mori. I'm like, okay, we can still work with this. I have Dofi. I play Dofi. He Stussies my Dofi. Then I'm like, okay, now his whole board is rested. Another Dofi, we can come back. And he plays another Stussy. And now his board is 4 9Ks and I have nothing on board. Sure, top decking Cody wins, but I didn't top deck the Cody. So yeah, basically from them having a really good setup to me seeing an out, and then they completely throwing me out of the game with that play. What I was going to say in addition to that is I really believe that a meta is somewhat slowing down. Sure, Law will always be here, but you have the technology to deal with Law, right? So this is kind of like hedging your bets that the game might go long and that you will have to deal with top end. And if you don't see Stage, you don't see Isha, you don't see Tempest Kick, Stussy just works most of the time.
Yeah, so my impressions were very, very similar at the start. I was like, why would I play this 9-cost trash when I can play Sabo? But as it turned out, Law is not that highly popular, and honestly, if you see top end, like, Law is still fine. Ideally, obviously, you want to clear two bodies at once when once you're in those late turns, but then you look at all the other matchups, and in those other matchups, well, I don't want to oversimplify things or exaggerate, but it does feel like Uchi's, you want to see some top end. You have to see some top end to win. Like, you counter, get to top end, and then the top end wins you the game. And this piece of searchable top end that can go tit for tat with literally anything your opponent plays is suddenly very appealing, because Sabo doesn't have two good targets in most matchups. Like, you can get some good, like, Tempest Kick Stage or Leader reductions to, like, counter the Moria play in the mirror, or, just against Red Purple Law and Blue kill two units. But usually, your biggest concern is going to be when you run out of those big bodies to play, and your opponent plays something like Tenko's Dofi or Rush Ace, the Tenko's Rush Ace, or basically all those decks that like to go and play long games, you want to be able to remove whatever they play, and Sabo turns out to be very expensive for that, discarding a card and requiring like some investment or cost reduction, whereas Tusi just, you know, comes in, kills anything, and the fact that you're trashing something on your own board isn't that much of a detriment either, because usually you have some leftover, like Spanda Morzuru or something that you might be missing in your trash, or Helmeppo that you're missing in your trash, and you just want to set up for a Moria. And then she's like a much... Okay, not too much nicer, sometimes nicer precursor to Moria than Sabo is, because Sabo obviously can discard the Rokubuchi and set up Moria that way. So yeah, kind of works both ways. But yeah, the more I play Rokubuchi in this specific meta that we have, the more I find myself favoring Stussy over Sabo. So yeah, changed my opinion on the card. Might actually have to get the Alberts.
Sure, it's rare for us. We spend a lot of time. We have a great understanding of the game, but from time to time, we are also wrong. And being able and routinely like question your stances on cards, matchups, and so forth is what will make you a good player. And Pride has, in general, no place in, I would say in life in general, but definitely in your life as a competitive card game player. Okay, now we move to one of my favorites. It's Hattori. Hervé, would you lead us with the man, the myth, the legend?
I mean, he's one of your favorites, so I love the pigeon, but I think you're the one who enlightened me and our testing group about this card, so I think you deserve the honors.
Okay, so Hattori is a 1-cost 0k 2k counter, animal CPO. He has an on-play on your turn, up to one of your Rokubuchi gains plus 2k power this turn. On the face, like on face value, this card is... So, a searchable 2k, so already great. And the only thing he gives you is, like, additional reach in the late game, because spending a whole card just to get one more Dawn this turn is rarely worth it. Like, Makino was worth it, because you get two additional Dawn value, so it's like a card for card almost, right?
Yeah, and potentially reusable, of course.
Well, Hattori is not that. It's just... Okay, maybe he pushes you through the finish line if you have to go for game. But a far more important aspect of this card is getting this card off of Moria. So if you think about it, you often play Moria and you hit Spandam with Moria, right? And you get a card, sometimes even Wayfang. Sure, you also trash cards. But getting Hattori off of Moria makes your leader swing 7. And effectively,
or which is, like the character,
which usually means instead of your opponent countering, you are actually removing something from the board. That's an insane change of events compared to just running a Spandam, right? Because it's far more impactful than you just getting a card, which might even be an uncounter card, right? Getting Hattori off of Moria is what really sealed this card in our mind as something which is relevant and actually strong. Sure, you should probably not play a playset of these, but a very, very potent 2K. And it will not, like, break... anything, but it's just a nice little piece of optimization that you can do for your Luge list.
Yeah, so specifically that use case that Christian, when he explained it to us, just get it off of Moria and effectively turn your leader swing into another removal for the turn, or like near guaranteed removal, is like so potent compared to just Spandam with decent chances of whiffing, like he keeps whiffing forever. for both me and others. Like, that's just such a good use case. And I just want to talk about the art. Like, they drew a pigeon doing the Gainax pose. Like, how based is that?
Yep.
I cannot believe it. I have to put up a comparison screenshot with, like, I don't know, Simon probably from Danganronpa Gurren Lagann. Like, hats off and all that to Bandai for this card. Yeah, definitely deserves a spot or two in the Robuchi deck, I think.
Mm-hmm. And to top it off, like, it also increases the amount of hits, because, like, oftentimes with Lucci, you will find yourself in a position where your Moria doesn't have a 2-cost target, right? A turtle-less-cost target. And that just added consistency to the deck. Okay, now we move to Mayan Hrvoje's.
Yeah, you know, we were wrong about Stussy, but we were not wrong about this
so
card.
So, a little bit of context. We are definitely part of community in general. We interact with people, and we have been even before we proved ourselves with our results, right? And especially previously, in a certain forum called Reddit, Hrvoje was engaging with the local populace, discussing the most broken card, Morgans. So the people posted, if you weren't around when this card was revealed, it was basically pandemonium. People were like, wow, this completely breaks the game. All the competitive players, once they know your hand, like, you're done for. The way they're thinking about the game is completely different than your usual people, and Morgans will just completely break the game because you know exactly how much counter they have. I mean, roughly exactly, right? Because they hide one card. I think you're qualified to take the lead here.
So yeah, it wasn't just Reddit, it was literally like Twitter, Discords, Reddit, everyone was like, oh my god, this card's so broken, you'll get to see your opponent's hand, you have full information, like, so broken. And I think a lot of this stems from a decent number of players having history in Yu-Gi-Oh! And in Magic, where hand knowledge is quite powerful. Yu-Gi-Oh! had like Mind Crush and Triple Tactics Talent, a bunch of hand loop cards that looked at your opponent's hand and they were like, okay, now you know what you need to play around. But problem is, in Yu-Gi-Oh!, like, when you look at those five cards, that's basically it for what your opponent's going to see for the rest of the game. There's no, like, five turns in Yu-Gi-Oh!. Like, the five or six cards you start with, that's it. And Magic, similarly, you're only drawing from the top of your deck. There's no, like, life that's giving you extra cards. So you're already, by seeing their first seven cards with, like, the...
Thoughtseize,
I forget what the card is called, but there's the black card that, like... Thoughtseize, probably. You look at their seven cards and suddenly you see like half of the cards they're going to see in their entire game. And now that's very valuable information. You know what land drops they have, what you have to play around, whatnot. But then One Piece is different. First of all, this card already, you look at their hand and they choose to discard one. And they stop showing you their hand and then they draw one card. That's already one card you don't know from their hand that you just saw. And then the card they're going to draw for turn, that's two cards you don't know. And they're going to draw a card from life at some point, another card from top of deck, and so on and so on. It turns out you're just not going to have complete information on their hand at all. And even if you did, even if you got all that value, the problem is you still paid one card out of your hand to Don to play this Morgan down. He's not going to attack. He's a 2k. Like, there's very few like late game scenarios where this could come up, but ideally you would just have a Spundum Surge or something in its place that replaced itself in your hand. So yeah, he's not going to come up as an attacker, and you can make an argument, well, you can play him off of Moria, but then you're just giving up potential value elsewhere. And what did you actually give your opponent? Well, you gave them a banned ability. Sakazuki Leader had this ability where you just discard any card from your hand and draw a new card. And that's what Morgan gives to your opponent. A one-time use of get rid of my worst card in this current game state and hope to draw a new one. And why would you want to do that? Like, why would you want to help your opponent at the small chance of getting some useful information, like seeing they have no 2Ks or something very unlikely like that? Just awful card that a lot of people, I think, overestimated because of their preconceptions coming from other
cards. It's a thought experiment. So let's say this card shows the whole hand and they don't get the cycle. Yeah, so not only does he keep one card hidden from your opponent, but they also get the cycle. Pretty bad. But let's say he didn't do that. Let's say your opponent shows you their whole hand. Would the card at that point be good? I argue not, but I want to see your opinion.
It would be closer to play, but I still wouldn't play it. It's like still, if there's like some balance point of like 50% where card is not playable here and playable here, it will still only be like 35%-ish to playability for me. I just don't rate hand information, like explicit hand information in One Piece as high, because it usually doesn't affect your play patterns anyways, and through like good combat basics, you can glean out your opponent's hand anyways, and also through just knowledge of your opponent's deck. Like if you're playing against Bonnie, you know what their best play on 4 is, you know what their best play on 6 is, and so on and so forth. So if they don't do that play in this game state, well, they probably just don't have the card, and now that's something you can carry in your head for the rest of the game. Just keeping in mind, they might top deck it later when it's not the optimal play anymore. There's a lot of information you can gather without explicitly seeing the contents of your opponent's hand. I just wouldn't even then play.
I mean, there is an argument that maybe the game moves in the direction where there are a lot of cards which you really need the knowledge of. I'm trying to think from the top of my head.
Okay, but let's see. You look at your opponent's hand and see they have three Morias. And you look at your hand, you have one Moria.
No.
How does that help you?
Like, what are the cards which you can really play around? Like, okay, I know that my opponent has this in hand, and now I can abuse that knowledge. Sure, lack of 2Ks, but that's relatively rare. What's a high impactful card?
What's a
high impactful card that you can play around?
Reject.
Sure. Like, in general, the explosive yellow stuff, right? Some specific top end, like
Big Mom.
You see Stussy, maybe you play around Stussy, maybe like you clear the board of the little guys. What else?
The problem is, if there's this one card that would blow you out, like, if you're looking for specific knowledge, say you have your hand is like full of options, and you're just looking for which option is correct. Would you pay one card and two Dawn to find out which option is correct, or would you just, you know, consider the options?
Yeah,
like,
course.
Okay, if they have this, I'm losing this. If they have this, I'm losing a bit more. So I'm going to play around this one that makes me lose a bit more because I have the options. Why pay extra to find the right option?
The best season I had was by playing an additive value deck. Like, the whole reason why Mario was great, every card was value. So no, I would never play a card which does nothing essentially. So yeah.
But yeah, I'm glad we got to vent about how
it's been a long time coming.
Awful this card is. I'm gonna put in some like screenshots of Twitter and Reddit and Discord. Maybe add some montage music. Like, I'll figure something out. Maybe the circus music. We'll see.
Okay, let's move on to Zombie Luffy. Zombie Luffy is a 5-cost 6K Straw Hat crew with a counter. He has, when attacking, Teresh up to one of your opponent's character with a cost 2 or less. So, not KO. Just move into the trash. Then, you can bottom deck any number of 4 costs from your trash, and for every 3 he gets plus 1k. So, this card was a way to,
Eliminate
Sabo. But the more I'm knowledgeable about this format, the less I like this card. In general, like, clearing Sabo in that matchup is not as relevant. Sure, you can prep him and then go for Little Dan, but they might have two Sabos.
Or they might just set up 9k one
or life. Or do that, right? So, dealing with Sabo is not my number one priority versus Black Yellow Luffy. It's more surviving with blockers and efficient plays, and then basically destroying their hand, right? Isha is far more important, for example. Now, how good is this card in the mirror, where Sabo is also important? Well, he's just a 5-cost do nothing, right? And then next turn, if your opponent somehow doesn't KO it, then it does something. Like, in general, cards, as usual, cards which do nothing on play have to be really insane. Once again, I think I have to remind people weekly that I won quite a lot of tournaments without playing Kuzan in my Moria list. Because, sure, you get a draw on play, but like the main effect is when attacking, right? That's the main appeal of Kuzan. And if you just get removed, there are probably better things you could be doing. And compared to Kuzan, this card is not as good. And same logic would apply here. Sure, he has a counter, so he is somewhat safer. So you can like counter him in matchups where you don't need him. But he's like compared to, I don't know, Brook. The thickest Brook, right? The comparison is very unfavorable for our boy Luffy.
Yeah, and even to the 6-cost mm-hmm. Brook, if you're specifically looking to out the Sabos and whatnot, like, just trash the thing.
I mean, but it's Brook. Not. I mean, you're comparing a 5-cost to a 6-cost, a counter with a non-counter, but yeah, I would still rather play the 6-cost Brook, and I even don't like that card as well.
Yeah, if you think about tech cards which decks include nowadays to counter, specifically Black Yellow Luffy, the one that's probably most comparable to is Pudding, where you have this card that's, you know, potentially very impactful, unsearchable, not going to be relevant for most matchups. But, you know, if you can play it out, it's nice. If you draw it, it's nice. And then you compare the impact this has, the impact Pudding has, and it's like night and day, because you could try to set this up against the Black Yellow Luffy as well, but there's actually no guarantee they're not going to out it. They run removal cards. Like, they have to not die to, like, the Bonclays and to Shurayas and to Zoro from Bonnie, so they do pack some cost reduction or removal for bigger units. So there's no guarantee you're even having to survive into Black Yellow Luffy. And then the price you're paying is just so high. You lose one card in so many matchups, and you have this unsearchable thing you're not going to draw for most games into Black Yellow Luffy. I think the price is just too high.
Yep. Okay. Let's move on to Joseph.
Oh, we're doing Joseph? Okay. Okay, 1-cost 2k, 1000 counter, on play place two cards with type CP from trash to the bottom of the deck, KO, 1-cost. And where does this guy find his place? Well, once again, it's mainly going to be in Moria place, because he gives you a way to remove stuff on the 2-cost slot of the Moria revival. Notably, the biggest synergy is obviously going to be the turn after you Isho, and then you have the blanket minus 3-cost across the entire board, giving you potential to remove up to 3 units just off of one Moria against a white board of like Red Purple or Blue Doffy or Rage or one of those decks that just has a lot of, you know, 4, 5, 6 cost units. And then you just do like the blanket reduction on everything, toss in a minus 1, minus 2 there, and suddenly everything dies. Obviously, he fills in for when you don't have the full Rebecca, Spandine, Lucci line to fully defend with to both have a blocker and removal. He fills in by being a removal on the 2-cost slot and can also synergize with Brook a bit further. Obviously, it's not something you want to play early, despite the fact that he's a low cost, just because 2 cards from trash is a hefty 2 CP cards specifically from trash is a very hefty cost to pay in the early game when you're still preparing your trash for future plays. So, yeah, it's like attack option. If you like it, if you feel you need it, it's there.
You hit most of the talking points. The one I would also add is, in general, Moria turns it almost kind of scripted. Like on 4, you want a KO effect, right? And on the lower end, you want something to reduce. But there's quite a lot of 4 cost good reducers, right? With Kauko and Khalifa. And this opens up yet another suitable Moria play, because just getting one body removed, especially in the Black Mirror, is usually enough. And this can clear basically everything, right? With Leader and Kaku, you can, I don't know, remove their Kaku or a leftover Sabu. So it just gives you another Moria configuration, which is not nothing, right? In addition to being a CP card. So any conspicuous cards which might find itself in the list at most one or two copies. Lucci, 5 cost, is an interesting card. So he's a 5 cost 6k, again CP typed, with a 1k counter. On play, your bottom deck 3 cards from your trash. And then your opponent discards a card. You take a look at their trash, and you can take any one card and bottom deck it. So in general, this card is very mid. Like, getting to discard one card from your opponent is, like, whatever. So for this card to... It does have a synergy hook with Erdor. It's yet another decent target, CP target, which is a 5 cost, right? But to get most out of this card, and like the reason to play it, is that the bottom deck has to be relevant, right? And let me give you some examples where it is very relevant. In the mirror, I bottom deck your only Lucci. That can be game swinging. Like, completely game swinging. Like, if that's your only Lucci, or if you cannot discard the other Lucci from your hand, now you can no longer play Moria. And that can be, as I said, you can probably win the game from that point, right? If your opponent cannot play Lucci for a couple of turns. If your opponent cannot play Moria for a couple of turns, right? The other point is Reiju as well. You can button deck their Ichijis, their big Reijus, like all their big Rangers. Versus Nami, you bottom deck their cards. But most importantly, versus Black Yellow Luffy, not only do they have to discard a card, which is extremely important in that matchup, you can bottom deck a 5 cost. And they are really, really restricted with those. God forbid, if you can bottom deck one of their Black Sabos, you are doing yourself a huge service. Oftentimes, they will have one or two Sabos. There are definitely games where they see only one. That sub is on the board. They will opportunistically block with it just so they can get it back next turn. You stick them with this, and you might once again win the game because that one bottom decking is important. So in general, the card is mid. However, if bottom decking is relevant, that's the sole reason why you might bring this card in. Want to add something, Karabai?
I think you got most of the talking points. Like, yeah, he's just comparable to Perona or X-Drake. I guess more to X-Drake because there's no limit mm-hmm. on the opponent's hand size to this card. But you can use him the same way as you would X-Drake. If they go too low on you hand size, like protecting their board, then this can be an unexpected punish, and that's the only element I think you didn't mention. But yeah, just all around the middling card that can find the great uses.
Yep. Let's talk about Tempest Kick, the fake eruption.
Eruption. So yeah, it's 1 cost CP. Draw 1 card. If you have 10 or more cards in trash, give something -3 cost and trigger KO at 3 cost or less. So first of all, the basic ruling that everybody should know, if you have 9 cards in trash and you activate this, this immediately goes to trash and counts as the 10th card. It's something that people who played Rebecca in OPO4 would know already, but worth mentioning. Oh yeah, in most cases, in early game, this is just going to be a quick filter, the same way you would use an eruption. But later on, if you actually do get 10 cards in trash, this is far more potent because -3 cost on one card that replaces itself is just really good. Being searchable within this specific archetype obviously matters as well. Yeah, I mean, Great Eruption was banned. This is like the softened version of Great Eruption with higher upside. So I think it's a pretty obviously a strong card. I don't actually think it's a guaranteed 4-off in every Luchi deck. I could see it being played as a 3-off. I've tried it as a 3-off and didn't mind it too much. But yeah, generally just the best cost reduction option that Luchi has in event form.
In general, the way Luchi decks are built, the time where you actually need reduction is in the later stages of the game, right? Where you want to pop multiple things with Luchi or maybe Sabo, right? So the drawback of you having to have a lot of cards in trash is actually less relevant than we thought previously, right? Sure, you have to play around it. Also, this makes you interested in some other cards which you probably wouldn't otherwise. Namely, I've been doing a lot of testing with Erdor, because Erdor immediately turns this Tempest Cake on, right? Also, it makes you less... it makes you more wary to use effects with your bottom deck cards from your trash. Because if you, I don't know, do Moria relatively early with Luchi, you might not be able to Tempest Cake at a later point. But if you are careful, Tempest Kick would definitely carry you in the late game. And I think it's definitely one of the reasons why Luchi is such a strong deck, because at the in the later stages of the game, you can clear incredible boards with this and being resist efficient. So yeah, great card. Frankie 2K is yet another 2K yellow 2K, which ends up being almost universally loved, especially at least in an alt, because he can always hover around one life, right? So he's 4 cost 5K, so already we are jiving with that. He's a 2K, as we said. His trigger is draw one card. And if it's only that, you would probably never do it unless you're 2K swamped, right? But if you have one or less cards, so he had to be your last life or your second to last life, right? Play this card without any cost, without having to discard anything. Just play this dude out. How good that is? Well, it's incredible. If it just played itself for free, it would have been pretty strong. The fact that he also draws a card is... that's... very, very strong. The restriction is it has to be your second or your last life. Second to last life or your last life. For Nell, not a big issue. For Katakuri, you can... if you see him, you can put him down and then push him up, right? It's definitely gonna be, I think, an evergreen yellow card, especially if you have any kind of synergy with it. It's the power level is just very, very high. Want to add anything?
Yeah, I think this is one of those things in One Piece design that I really hate, and it's like, I already said this when we were discussing You're the One Who Should Disappear way back, but it's designed in a way that promotes like the unenjoyable aspects of gameplay. Like, this only works if it's in the like lower life triggers, which makes it all the more frustrating, all the more like potentially game flipping, because it's a 5k body that replaces itself for free. Like, it's just a very frustrating thing to face when it, you know, when things go south because of something like this. It feels bad as the same way as it does with the Zero Quest event or with Bege. I just think it's awful design and something that Bandai should really, you know, steer clear of. But they obviously don't think the same because, yeah, they made this card. I just genuinely don't think this card should exist.
I would agree. That's all we'll say about Frankie. What about Rocket Luffy?
Okay, so he has fantastic art in both base and alt art. 5 cost 6k, 1000 counter. Activate main if you have 2 or less life. KO opponent's 4 cost by trashing this and then draw 1 card. And then trigger KO opponent's 4 cost. So yeah, this card is good just on all fronts. Where do I start? So first of all, there is that small restriction. You need to be on 2 life. This is mainly going to affect the Black Kill Luffy when the opponent doesn't willingly bring you down to 2 life. So you might be impaired in your ability to remove stuff. But when you think about how this card works, it's actually just the best removal event we've had so far. Because when you look at like Jet Pistol or 3000 Worlds, whatever, it's a counterless card. That does have a trigger, to be fair, but it doesn't... you just give a card from hand, give the Dawn, and you KO something. And to be fair, this does cost 5, but it replaces itself in hand immediately. If you have 2 main in hand, you can counter with some of them. If you don't need to remove something, this can just stay as a body on board and remove something later. It's just good on all fronts. And then it also does have the trigger to kill a 4 cost, which is, you know, the yellow Zora promo and... almost Tonami level, almost Thunderbolt level. Just all around a good card. I think a bit pushed on all fronts, and obviously consistency boost to Black Tail Luffy.
A huge,
like, the only downside this card has,
like, getting actual card draw in that deck is extremely relevant.
Yeah, the fact that he can turn Moria into A cost 9k, kill 2 of your opponent's things, draw 2 cards, which is just insanity. But yeah, the only downside, literally the only downside for this card I can think of, is if you're playing an L, he turns off the protection effect of your own 7 cost, and that's literally it. That's the only thing that's suboptimal about this card.
Sure. But yeah, a very bad card. Yeah, it might also be an evergreen for yellow.
For sure.
What about... the secret rares, this time both of them are pretty strong. Let's discuss the more controversial one, I would say. Let's discuss Sabo. So, currently Sabo is being run in almost every Lucha list. And I keep telling people, sure, you can play Sabo, but you're not playing Sabo for Sabo. You're playing Sabo as a contingency plan, right? You're playing Sabo if you didn't draw Moria. He's basically like, well, I don't have Moria, so here you go, take my Sabo. He's most impactful versus Law, because with minimal setup, you can clear 2 bodies, right? And in general, he's your top end when you don't have a better top end. Having to discard a card is bad, but clearing 2 bodies is relevant. So as long as you can clear 2 bodies with Sabo, you are probably fine. People are pretty happy with playing Sabo, but I think that they should be reminded that Sabo is a consolidation prize. He's there because we cannot play 6 Morias. We would. Yeah, wanna add anything?
Yeah, look at this angle, like something people aren't thinking about, but Revo Army Garp.
Yeah.
Yep. Like, I bet you didn't think of that. No, I agree. It's like, if you don't have Moria, you need some top end. As I said earlier, Uchi does really want to see some top end to stay in the game. And Sabo is like the third best option, like the third wheel. It's between him and Stussy. Because I think both Isha and Moria end up being, like, Moria obviously the best black card, the best card in the game. And then Isha is really strong into your weakest matchup and just strong into a lot of other decks. And then it's just like, do you want Sabo or Stussy more? Which decks do you want to have a smoother game plan against. Obviously, he's playable in other decks as well. Like, Sabo is actually quite key in Perona to deal with Red Purple Law, because she doesn't have that many ways to clear two bodies at once. Like, there's some decks you can play, like Shark Arrows, which we mentioned previously in the channel. But those are a bit more difficult and convoluted to pull off than just here's an 8 cost, discard the card. Especially because Perona doesn't really lack in the card economy with the Samurai build. All around a solid card. Probably going to see play here and there when the white boards need to be kept under control. And they're higher priority.
And for example, if
than the not white boards. If Moira gets banned, he's going to rise in popularity.
That's what
for
I was
sure.
going to say. Like, if there's a world where Moira gets banned, then Sabo is... Then basically Sabo probably takes over his slot, and you probably play like even a playset of Sabo's, because there's nothing else you can do then, right? Removing two big bodies is still the best thing you can do late game, and Sabo will be your go-to then. But at this point, yeah, basically outshined by and outclassed by his classmates, both Moria and Isha. And playing him just because you need more. Okay. And last but not least, 10 cost, Yellow Ace.
Something nobody asked for. Enel gets another way to heal and another way to remove things, which is this time focused on combat, like Katakuri and Yamato remove stuff through their effects. But Thrush Ace, 10 cost 10,000 on play, add up to one card from top of your life to the life cards, and then if you have two or less life cards, he gains rush, which means he can attack into any rested unit or phase, whatever suits your needs. He doesn't have to attack at all. And when you look at when you compare him to Yamato or Katakuri, there's like effectively no condition to his healing. Like, if you want to heal with Katakuri, you have to give up a unit on board. If you want to heal with Yamato, you need to be on one life. Ace can always heal you. Like, if you're playing a very long drawn out mirror with Enel, and you're just building up life, or if you're playing Vegapunk even, you can just give yourself that one life and chill. But also, if you're in the need of the effective removal by Rush, then you can play him, not gain a life, stay on 2 life, and just Rush, hit something. A flexible card, a really good boss monster with two very nice arts. Like, I think base art is much nicer compared to the alt art, because...
Yeah.
Which is the opposite for Sabo, where the base art he looks like a squirrel. But just a solid card. Probably isn't going to see any play in the blue yellow ace, I would say. But he does have the typing for searching. So maybe in some red yellow deck you just search him with ease on, like, play the wire parts engine and have this as your top end. There's some potential there that I didn't really think about it before saying it now, but now that I consider it, it is there. Could see potential in the future, and unlike a previous yellow boss monster of Tenko's Lin Lin, he is generic, so you can run him in any leader. There's always potential there.
The very genericness of the card really brings it up. I would just also say that, yeah, now when you're playing versus yellow, especially versus NL, you always want to keep them on 2 life. Because not only you are turning off Yamato, you're also turning off Ace. So yeah, you keep him in 2 and then try to pressure them in 1 turn. Okay, Hiroe. We did it. Yet another set.
We did do it.
Set gone through. Any closing thoughts about OPO 7?
I'm glad it shook up the meta. Like, I'm glad there's so many options. Oh, that's a lie. I'm not glad. It's entertaining to see, but as you know, I prefer metas where it's just like one dominant deck and then your preparation is very focused, and you know what to expect from pretty much every opponent in the tournament. I don't like metas where it's just so widespread and you can play anything, but it is a breath of fresh air. I'm glad that Bandai shows that they can design archetypes that, you know, evolve in different ways, and especially we've seen some results put up by very old decks with just a few new cards of support, and I think that shows great promise for the future of the game. It doesn't personally suit my tastes for this specific format, but I know what's coming. I'm looking forward to the OPO 8 RPL domination, I just enjoy a lot of the cars that were made in this set. I think there's a lot of stuff that now has legs that didn't have them before. I wouldn't like it to have as many legs on competitive level, but yeah, overall quite happy with the set. A lot of beautiful art as well, which I'm a really big fan of, so yeah, overall.
I really want to emphasize this, that when I started playing One Piece, everybody and their mother cautioned me with Bandai always destroys their game with the design, with the power creep. And sure, we got some power creep, but like I'm still enjoying the game. I don't think that they're making any huge design mistakes. Like sure, some things are not to my taste. The 2K Frankie, right? But in general, I'm constantly pleased with the game design work on One Piece. And I think all of us should be hopeful. I think that the game is in really good hands. I do believe that there's always something problematic. I really believe that Moria is in general a problematic card. I believe that Black Maria is something has to give, and I don't think they ever.
I'm really curious who pitched that and who approved that and who didn't slap the first too silly.
What that kind of effect without being later locked. I don't know. Also, in general, I believe that RP Law might be a mistake, like as a leader. Like, he might have to get the Sakazuki treatment of Sayonara. But in general, I agree with Herve. By the way, this has been, we haven't worked as hard, maybe ever, preparing. Because there's so many decks to work through. So many ideas to try. All the decks have more than enough spots where you can play around with different tech options. It's a really nice guide.
Yeah.
And I really like the art. I know a lot of people don't like the art, but I find the art very, very nice. A great time to be a One Piece player. The meta has never been as diverse. And there's like a ton of tier 1 decks, but there's even more tier 2 decks. Like, the amount of tier 2 decks playable this format is. So, Opio 7. Both a very good set, we would say. And that's it from us. You can see us in Milan this coming weekend. Drop by, say hi. And that is all. We hope to see you earlier than... we hope that the interval between the episodes will be less so. But things happen.
Yeah, expect the report after Milan. That's what we're seeing.
Okay. Everybody, thank you for joining us, and see you when we see you. Bye-bye.